promote themselves to the heavenly planets, such as the moon. There are many heavenly planets to which they aspire just to achieve more and more material happiness by getting a long duration of life and a paraphernalia for sense enjoyment. But the attached persons do not know that even if one goes to the highest planet, Brahmaloka, destruction exists there also. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that one can even go to the Brahmaloka, but still he will find the pangs of birth, death, disease and old age. Only by approaching the Lord's abode, the Vaikuntha Loka, does one not take birth again in the material, in this material world. The Grihanidhis are materialistic persons. However, do not like to use this advantage. They would prefer to transmigrate perpetually from one body to another and from one planet to another. They do not want the eternal blissful life in knowledge in the kingdom of God. There are two kinds of dissolutions. One dissolution takes place at the end of the life of Brahma. At that time, all the planetary systems, including the heavenly planets, including the heavenly systems, are dissolved in water and enter in the body of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who lies on the Garbhodaka ocean on the bed of serpents called Shesha. In another dissolution, which occurs at the end of Brahma's day, all the lower planetary systems are destroyed. When Lord Brahma rises after his night, these lower planetary systems are again created. The statement in Bhagavad Gita that persons who worship the demigods have lost their intelligence is confirmed in this verse. The less intelligent persons do not know that even if they are promoted to the heavenly planets, at the time of dissolutions, they themselves, the demigods and all the planets will be annihilated. They have no information that eternal blissful life can be attained. So this chapter, entitled Entanglement in Fruitive Activities, Lord Kapila, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is speaking to his mother Devahuti. And in this chapter, he's telling Mother Devahuti about how living entities, human beings especially, get entangled in this material world due to their engagement in fruitive activities. That's how this chapter is called, Entanglement in Fruitive Activities. This is the fourth verse, and all along from verse 1, he's been talking about this. Griha Medhiyam, this was verse number 1, Athova Griha Medhiyam, and in this verse also he says Ta Ete Griha Medhiyam, the same word Griha Medhiyam is used here, and Prabhupada is elaborating on the purpose about what are the symptoms of a Griha Medhi and how he is different from a grihastha or a devotee who is completely attached to rendering devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So here, it is also mentioned about the two kinds of annihilation is also mentioned here. And this has been mentioned with reference to, again, the subject and the discussion that the Grihavedis do not realize that the fruitive activities will keep him entangled in this material world, and this material world has an end. And in this material world, nobody can get free from the pangs of birth, death, old age and disease. Even the highest personality in this material universe, that is Brahma, also has a life. He is not eternal. Of course, we are all eternal, the soul is eternal, but encaged in this body, we are undergoing birth, death, old age and disease. So the two kinds of dissolution that is mentioned here is, one is that takes place at the end of the life of Brahma, where all the planetary systems, including the heavenly systems, are dissolved in water and enter into the body of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. And then again the creation begins again, where Brahma and all other demigods are created. Brahma is born from the womb of, from the navel of Vishnu. And the other dissolution is which occurs at the end of Brahma's day. So Brahma's day and Brahma's lifetime, these are the two kinds of dissolution that is mentioned. Brahma's day means all planets, Brahma's day means Brahma goes to sleep. And while Brahma is sleeping, only Brahma Loka exists. All other planets below him are dissolved, because Brahma is not existing. If all the planets below him have to exist, Brahma should be there governing and managing. So since Brahma has gone to sleep, all the planets below Brahma Loka go into a state of dissolution. So these are the two kinds of dissolution. And of course we also know that at the end of Kali Yuga is another kind of a very partial annihilation, not dissolution really. So that's another type, and the cycle begins with Satyuga. So at that time only things on planet Earth is destroyed. So one is on planet Earth, the other are all planets below Brahma, Brahmaloka, and the third is the entire, all the planets in this universe. So the Griha Medhis, yata yate Griha Medhinam, tada loka layam yanti. So the Griha Medhis, their goal is tada loka. They want to go to the upper planets. Why do they wish to go to the upper planetary system? Because they think that there is much more enjoyment in the upper planetary system, and they want to enjoy. But they have no idea that that enjoyment is temporary, because the planets themselves are temporary. So Prabhupada is writing, the materially attached are very eager to promote themselves to the heavenly planets such as the moon. There are many heavenly planets which they aspire, just so that they can achieve more and more material happiness and attain a longer duration of life. But they do not know the reality of all the planets in this material world. Only by approaching the Lord's abode, that is Vaikuntha Loka, one does not take birth in this material world. So this is actually the most important knowledge, which by the mercy of Prabhupada, all of us know it so nicely, so clearly, that there is an eternal life, we are all eternal, and that eternal life full of happiness can be experienced only in that eternal planet, which is Vaikuntha. That eternal blissful life cannot be attained in this material planet. So Prabhupada has explained it so clearly to us that there are two worlds, the material world and the spiritual world. And the goal of life is actually to go into the spiritual world. And for that, there is a different process. And that process is devotional service to Vishnu. We are so fortunate, we don't realize, just last week I had an opportunity to meet some few people and I was explaining to them this material world and the spiritual world. And people outside are actually absolutely clueless about the existence of another world, a world where there is no birth, death, old age, disease, a world where there is eternal bliss. And they say, where does it mention? And from where are you doing all these things? This is something completely alien to them. And that is why they are exactly as what is described in this verse, Griha Medhinam. Because they have no knowledge. Here also Prabhupada writes somewhere, either in this or in the previous book, but they have no knowledge of the existence of another world. And so for them, because everybody wants to enjoy, everybody wants to be happy, we also want to enjoy, we also want to be happy, but because for them they have no knowledge that there is another kind of a happiness, another kind of a world, for them they are just eager and very enthusiastic to enjoy this material world. And nothing more than that they know. They are so attached. So as Prabhupada mentioned earlier, Grihamedis and Grihasthas. Grihamedi, their goal in life, their objective in life is sense gratification. But for devotees who are self-realized, their goal in life is not self-gratification, but self-realization. And there are, in the Bhagavatam, Prahlad Maharaj, when he was praying to Lord Narasimha Deva, and when Narasimha Deva asked him that, you know, you want anything from me, please ask. So what was Prahlad Maharaj's reply? His reply was that I do not want anything for myself, because I am happy rendering devotional service to you, I am happy singing and chanting your holy name. But my concern is Shoche. He is language, Shoche Tato Vimukha Chetasa Indriyatha. Vimukha Chetasa means the Grihamedis. Those who have become averse to Krishna, because they have no knowledge. They have no knowledge of God, the existence of the spiritual world. Or even if they have some knowledge, they are not really interested in a life of they are not interested in rendering devotional service. They just want to engage in sense gratification, and that's why he says maya sukhaya bharam udvahato vibhura. So the Grihamedis, they are after indriyartha, sense gratification, and their happiness is maya sukhaya. Maya sukhaya means temporary and illusory happiness, and they are actually, why it is temporary and illusory? Because bharam means they have taken on, bhara means load, right? So they have taken on load, or you can also call bhara as responsibility. This is my bhara, this is my load of responsibility. They have maya sukhaya bhara, they have taken on a false responsibility of engaging in their so-called material duties. They think that these material duties are all in all, and this is my responsibility, and there is nothing more than this. That is why they are bharam, this load, udvahato vimhuram. Vimhuram means they are actually mudha. Vimhura means they are actually, Prabhupada writes, fools and rascals. Because actually this is not really happiness. On the other hand, Rishabhadeva is saying, for he is telling his son that we should engage in some tapasya, some austerity. Because by engaging in some tapasya or austerity, you will get Brahma Saukhya. So maya sukhaya and brahma saukhya. Maya sukhaya is the false happiness which the materialists, the Grihamedis are engaged in, and brahma saukhya is what, again, Vishvadeva is, you know, the Supreme Person of Godhead, he is telling us this is what we should be engaged in, and for that little tapasya is required, not big amount of tapasya. Actually this tapasya also, if we take to the process of Krishna consciousness, what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us, this tapasya is also very pleasurable. So, what is the thinking of a materialist, and what is the thinking of a spiritualist? Grihamedi and one who is not a Grihamedi. It is very nicely, if we come across, if we go through that story of Sudama and Krishna, there are many other interesting points that comes up. If you know, you all know the whole story of Sudama and Krishna. Sudama was a very dear devotee and a dear friend of Krishna. He was a very nice friend of Krishna, and he was in complete knowledge. And because he was in knowledge, he was not attached to material sense gratificatory activities, and he was very, very peaceful. So he had a lot of good qualities, but the most important quality that Sudama had was he was always satisfied. A Grihaveeri is never satisfied. No matter how much he has, he wants to accumulate more and more and more. Whereas that is not the position of a devotee. A devotee knows, a devotee is in perfect knowledge. What is perfect knowledge? Perfect knowledge means that I am destined to enjoy this much happiness and I am destined to suffer this much miseries. I cannot be happier than what I am destined to be. So he will always be happy and satisfied, come what may. That is a symptom of a devotee. And the opposite is for a non-devotee, never satisfied. So Sudama, he knew that he was actually very poverty stricken. They had no food to eat, they had not enough clothes to, you know, put on their body, and they were all very skinny and very, you know, very bony. But he would always think of Krishna. This is another symptom of a devotee. First, that he is always satisfied in whatever condition he is in. And then the second symptom of a devotee is, even if he is in difficulty, whether he is in difficulty or not in difficulty, he is constantly thinking of Krishna. Because he knows that the situation that he is put in is because the Lord has sanctioned it, it is the Lord's blessing. So I must always be thinking of Lord, because that is what is my goal. Smartavya Satatam Vishnu. So his wife, Sudama's wife, she was also, not that she was unhappy with their poverty-stricken situation, but she was very concerned for her own husband, because he knew that my husband is a very pious Brahmana, a very nice Brahmana, and she couldn't stand seeing Sudama suffer. So she humbly requested Sudama that please go and approach Krishna. He is your friend. You have rendered a lot of service to him. You are all together. Of course, right now you are not rendering service to him, but you are always surrendered to him. And devotees who are always surrendered to the Lord are always helped by the Lord. And she said, you know, you are a very nice Brahmana and Krishna loves the Brahmana. Krishna is always protecting the Brahminical culture. So you please go and approach Lord Krishna and he will surely help you. He will help you come out of your impoverished situation. So this was the request. So even the wife, you know, please go to Krishna. Even if you have any requirements, you should go to Krishna. So Sudama, when he was requested from his wife, he was thinking what to do. Because he was thinking, why should I approach the Lord for my material needs? The Lord knows what my needs are more than me. He was feeling shy. He was feeling odd to approach the Lord so that he could get relief from his poverty-stricken situation. Just look at how a devotee is thinking. Look at how satisfied he was. He knew that Supreme Lord is his, you know, friend, but he was feeling odd to go and approach. A typical materialist is always asking more and more and more and more. But a devotee is always thinking, how can I remember the Lord more? Not to ask the Lord more for my material requirements. But nevertheless, because, you know, Sudama was, his wife was telling him, you must go. He somehow had a duty for his, you know, he thought, okay, since my wife is so much, you know, anxious and she's asking me so much, okay, let me go and at least meet Lord Krishna. And I may not ask him, I'm sure I don't want to ask him something, but that very meeting with the Lord itself will be very nice. And I will get an opportunity to meet him and to see him and have his darshan. So with this thing in mind, he decides, okay, let me go and see the Lord. And then, so once he makes up his mind, he asks his wife, So do you have something for me to carry for my Lord? I wish to give him something. Do you have any presentation for me to take to the Lord? This is another symptom of a devotee. Whenever he goes to the temple or whenever he is going to meet the Lord in the temple or of course in the temple, he will always want to take something for the Lord. That is why I remember when I was in college days, in that time we were all students. So all the students who would go to the temple, the pujari, you could call him the pujari prabhu. He was one of the pujari and he was very senior prabhu. So he would always tell all the students, even a student he would say, because as students we didn't have enough money with us because we just had, you know, what our parents would send. He said, just bring one rose flower or one fruit, one banana to the Lord. And that was a very nice habit that he had developed and cultivated, and later on many devotees would actually remember that it was so nice that whenever, that feeling that I am bringing something for the Lord, when I am visiting him, when I am meeting him, it's a very nice feeling, it's a very nice emotion. So the devotees always have this thought, have this feeling. So number one, being satisfied in any situation is a symptom of a devotee. Number two, never ask Krishna for any material benefit. Before that, number two, whenever in difficulty, remember Krishna always. Agriya Mary, whenever in difficulty, will he be able to remember Krishna always? No, he will sometimes, but most of the time, they will always be thinking, oh, I'm in difficulty, he will start planning, like in the Bhagavad Gita is written, I have this much wealth today, tomorrow I'm going to kill him, tomorrow I'm going to conquer him, and different things. So he starts planning based on things that he has with him. He's not thinking of the Lord. And then with this, so then he asks, so Sudama asks his wife what he has, and they were all very poor, and the wife just manages to get 4 palmfuls of chipped rice, and he packs it up, and she packs it in a small cloth and gives it to Sudama, and with that Sudama goes. And all along the way that Sudama was going to meet the Lord, he was constantly thinking of the Lord. He was very eager that I'm going to meet the Lord soon. Oh, what a wonderful meeting it is going to be. Like that, he was very, very eager. On the other hand, we see materialists, they are very eager for their material sense gratification, for increasing their material assets. A devotee is eager to increase his spiritual assets. How can I chant more? How can I render more service to the Lord? When can I come to the temple for darshan? This is how a devotee is always thinking. So Sudama, with this eagerness, he goes, and then all of his journey was very nice, because although he had no food to eat all along the way, but he was completely absorbed in the thoughts of the Lord and he was very happy. And then when he reaches the palace, he sees that that he had to cross 3 military encampments. That was the kind of security in Krishna Dwarka's Dwarka palace. And then he crosses, and then finally he meets the Supreme Lord Krishna. And in the Bhagavatam, it is very nicely described how the Supreme Lord welcomed Sudama. Sudama was a very poor, poverty-stricken, his clothes were all torn. But when Lord Krishna sees that Sudama is coming, he gets up from his chair and he goes forward to meet him. And then Lord Krishna goes and embraces Sudama. So this is the way when we become devotees, this is the way of the Lord. The Lord was more eager than, he was more eager than Sudama was, because both of them were very eager. But the Lord is more eager to meet the devotees. He doesn't see what is the position of the devotee, how educated, how qualified, how rich the devotee is. So the Lord goes and meets him and embraces him with his two hands, and then he washes Sudama's feet, and he takes the water from Sudama's feet, the water that has washed Sudama's feet, and sprinkles it on himself as if to purify him. This is how the Lord feels for his devotee, and this is the position the Lord places his devotees in. He places his devotees on a higher pedestal than him. And then he offers him nice fruits, nice drinks, makes him seated. He anoints his whole body with sandalwood pulp, another very nice scented ointment, and like that he gives him a very grand, a very nice, very loving welcome. Rukmini is fanning Sudama. Rukmini, the queen, the principal queen of Krishna, is fanning Sudama. And like that, they converse, and a lot of talk goes on, and they talk about how, when they were young and they were in a gurukul, and what the whole santa, they've gone to the forest to collect dry wood, and there was a big storm, and we know the story, and then they had they got lost, and whole night they were in the forest, and like that all the talks were going on. And then after the talk was over, then Krishna asked Sudama, "Sudama, have you brought something for me to eat? I'm sure your wife must have given you something." And then Sudama is feeling shy. He's feeling, "Oh, I've got this. Krishna is the king of Dwaraka. He must be getting so many nice palatable and opulent dishes every day. And my morsel of chip rice, what is this to the Lord?" And then the Lord knew what is going on in the heart of Sudama, but he was such a nice devotee. So Lord then tells Sudama, "Sudama, please do not, I know what is going on in your mind, but that morsel of chip rice which you have brought for me, I will eat it with lot of pleasure and relish and happiness than I would eat anything else, because you have brought this out of love for me. Bhaktya maam adijanati yavan yashchasmi tatvata." Only a devotee. Patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktya. Yome, only a bhakta, when he offers something to Krishna, Krishna will accept it, because he is offering it with love and devotion. So Krishna, so Sudama was still feeling, he was feeling odd, he was hiding the chip rice behind his hand, and the Lord goes and snatches it from him, and then he eats it, and the Lord with his, he takes a morsel of it, and then he goes to take the second, bite, and at that time Rukmini says that there's a very nice So Krishna tells Sudama, "I consider that this quality of chip rice will satisfy not only me, but the whole creation. And when he attempted to eat a second morsel, Rukmini Devi, the goddess of fortune herself, checked the Lord by catching hold of her hand. And she told Lord, "My dear Lord, this one morsel of chip rice is sufficient to cause him who has offered it," that means the person has offered, that is Sudama, "to become very opulent in this life and to continue his opulence in the next life. My Lord, you are so kind to your devotee that even this one morsel of chip rice pleases you very greatly, and your pleasure assures the devotee is opulent in both this life and the next life." So this indicates, Prabhupada writes, that when food is offered to Lord Krishna with love and devotion, and he is pleased and accepts it from the devotee, Rukmini Devi, the goddess of fortune, becomes so greatly obliged to the devotee that she has to go personally to the devotee's home to turn it into the most opulent home in the world. See, the Grihastha, the Grihamehi, their goal is to be very opulent, be very rich, have a lot of things for enjoyment. The formula for enjoyment is here. even in the material world, not in the spiritual world. The formula for enjoyment in the material world is like this. And we know the outcome of the story, how Sudama's, he couldn't recognize what his house had become. His house had become like a palatial mansion. His wife had become like a demigod. So this is the way. Please the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If the Supreme Personality of Godhead is pleased, then the devotee's home can turn into the most opulent home in the world. It's not about a karmic, anyone's home, and specifically devotee's home. If one feeds Narayana sumptuously, the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi, automatically becomes a guest in one's house, which means that one's home becomes opulent. And so like this, Sudama passed his night and he satisfied Krishna with whatever he had brought. And next morning, Sudama leaves. And then, it is very nice to note how a devotee should think. So, Sudama was thinking that yesterday I had such a nice time. The Lord personally embraced me. He left and the Lord did not offer him anything. If you go and meet a great personality like Krishna, who is the king, the supreme personality of Godhead, and you only have a nice meeting and he feeds you nicely, but he doesn't give you anything, what will our minds think? Right? So next morning, Sudama leaves and Lord Krishna did not offer him even a penny. And he was on his way back. Just think about it. And on his way back, he was thinking, oh, this is how typically a devotee thinks. So on the way back, he was thinking, the Lord was so nice to me. He embraced me. Actually, the Lord's embrace is reserved only for two persons. One is Rukmini and the other is Balaram. Of course, he embraces his friends also. But by and large, in one place, Prabhupada says like this. So he was thinking, the Lord's embrace was only meant for Rukmini, but he embraced me. A poor brahmana with tattered clothes, I'm such a fallen brahmana. This is how he was thinking. Of course, he was the most exalted brahmana, but this is how he was thinking. And he was so filled with love and transcendental pleasure, thinking that the Lord embraced him, that nothing else came to his mind. And then further he was thinking, and the goddess of fortune, Rukmini, was fanning me. From her lotus hand, she would buy it. So like this, he was thinking. I was rendered service by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And like this, he went on thinking. And the Lord was massaging my leg and feeding me with his own hand. The Lord was practically worshipping me. Like this, he went on thinking. And then further, this is how a devotee should think. Quite contrary to how a non-devotee thinks. Further, he says, and the Lord did not give me a farthing. And this shows how kind the Lord was, that he did not give me a farthing. Because he knew very well that, he's saying, yet the Lord was so kind to me that he did not give me even a farthing, knowing very well that I am a poverty-stricken man who, if I got some money, might become puffed up and mad after material opulence and so forget him. Of course, he would have never become mad and he would have never become puffed up. But imagine, this is how his thinking was going on. This is a great devotee, Sudama. And so this is another learning, how a devotee should think. And another learning from this is that the Lord will place tests for his devotees to pass. The Lord was actually placing a test for Sudama, and the Lord knew that he would pass. So the statement of Brahmana Sudama is correct. An ordinary man who is very poor and prays to the Lord for benediction in material opulence, and who somehow or other becomes richer in material opulence, immediately forgets his obligation to the Lord. Therefore, the Lord does not offer opulence to his devotee unless the devotee is thoroughly tested. So many times in our lives also, a lot of tests the Lord will put. Of course, He is putting, and He will continue to put. It depends whether we are passing the test. And finally, like this, he goes to his house thinking like this, and there, you know, the whole story. He saw everything was wonderfully changed. He saw that the place of his cottage, in the place of his cottage, there was a big palace made of valuable stones and jewels, glittering like the sun, moon, and rays. There were many beautifully decorated parks in which beautiful men and women were strolling. In those parks, there were nice lakes full of lotus flowers and beautiful lilies, and there were flocks of multicolored birds. And seeing all these wonderful conversion, he began to think, does this palace belong to me, or it belongs to someone else? Is this the same place that I used to live? How come it has changed so wonderfully? And then Ramana's wife appeared, Sudama's wife appeared, and then she explained what had happened, and she herself was so beautiful that it seemed that a goddess of fortune had come to receive him. And like this, tears of joy fell from both Sudama and his wife, and you know, they understood the mercy of the Supreme Lord, and like this it goes on, and it was as if, because Krishna said, he is such a great devotee, I am going to give him so much opulence that will surpass the opulence of Indra. And when he entered in the inner chambers in his apartment in the palace, he saw that it was not an apartment, but it was the residence of the King of Heaven. Everything was made of ivory, of gold, of jewels, and the bedding was as white as milk and as soft as lotus. That is the kind of beds he had, and like this it goes on. And then, so from this we learn that if you give something to the Lord, you will always gain a million times more. So with this conviction, with this faith, a devotee is always ready to offer all that he has at the feet of the Lord, at the service of the Lord and his devotees. Not because he wants to gain million times more, because he knows that everything belongs to the Lord. It doesn't belong to me, I'm just a caretaker. How can the caretaker enjoy? The enjoyment is for by the person whom it belongs to. So devotee is so firmly fixed in this knowledge and so clear that anything that belongs to me actually doesn't belong to me. I'm just the possessor. The Lord has just given me to actually belongs to the Lord, so that it should be engaged in the Lord's service. And in return, the Lord giving him a million times more is just another side effect. So this is the way, that is how the kings in the past would live. Whatever they would get, they would know it's the treasury of the Lord. And because it was the treasury of the Lord and being used always in the Lord's service and in upholding Brahminical culture and protecting Vedic principles, is why they were also rich and opulent, because the Lord would give them more and more. So this is the final thing that we learn from this, the consciousness to be maintained, that when we get such wonderful benedictions from the Lord, we must remember it belongs to the Lord and it must be used but for the Lord's service. So it is, to be a devotee of the Lord is the real goal in life. We gain not only spiritually, we gain materially also. Whereas if we are not devotees of the Lord, if we are just maybe just trying to enjoy things for ourselves, there is no real gain actually. It is Maya Sukhaya. Whereas if we want Brahma Sukhaya, Brahma Saukhya, then we must engage in devotional service to the Supreme Personality of God. So we'll end here. Tathā Śrīmad-Bhāgavatam ki, Śrīla Prabhupāda ki, Tathā Śrīla Prabhupāda ki.